Now, right? So right now my book has officially started recording. We have officially started. All right, this is how it goes. My name is Bert Kreischer, and I'm reading my book.
Macmillan Audio presents Life of the Party, Stories of a Perpetual Man-Child by Bert Kreischer, read for you by the author.
Introduction. Bong hits are like strippers. They're best when shared with a group of friends, and that is what I was doing, taking a bong hit among friends when I got the phone call that would change my life. There have been a handful of times when I knew without a doubt that my life was now changing. All of them are in this book, and none of them would have happened if it wasn't for that one phone call. "It's Rolling Stone magazine," my roommate Blair said, passing me the phone. "They asked for you." Had I known what was coming, I might have paid more attention, but I was a sixth-year senior with no plans beyond that toke and the next game of frisbee golf. So instead, I held in the smoke and bubbled out a hello. As best I can recall, the man on the other end explained that he was a journalist and was interested in writing an article about my college, Florida State University, being the number one party school in the country. He needed a tour guide, he said, who knew the school inside and out. Since my name had been brought up by nearly everyone he'd spoken with, he wondered if there was a good week in November for him to fly down and, quote-unquote, observe. I agreed to show him around as the bong made its way back in front of me. I heard him laughing. "Are you doing a bong hit?" "Yup," I said, trying not to lose any smoke. He laughed, "Perfect," and hung up. I was, in fact, the perfect host for a journalist. I've been at the school longer than most of the teachers and knew everyone there was to know. Also, silence makes me uncomfortable, so I talked to fill dead air. Little did I know, I was about to become the subject of a 6.5-page article in Rolling Stone. Soon, everyone would learn that I skipped class, smoked weed, drank excessively, threw outrageous parties, didn't wear condoms, and was willing to shit in public if it meant winning election. All details I poured onto the writers. At the time, I was just hoping one of these stories would make it into the article, maybe followed by a flattering picture that I could frame on my wall to remind me of my college experience. I could have never expected what was to follow. My dad was the first one to call me at 8 a.m. on April 1st, 1997. "What the fuck did you do? I have news people camped in front of our house and the phone's ringing off the hook," as if straight out of a movie. The doorbell rang, with the phone still in my hand and my dad still shouting on the other end of the line. I opened the door to find a UPS man holding the most important parcel I'd ever received in my entire life. My issue of Rolling Stone. I hung up with my dad, plopped down on the couch, and flipped to the article titled "The Undergraduate." It should be noted, by the way, on that, I thought that that picture of Beck was me. Little side note to the listener. The first paragraph literally brought tears to my eyes. Of all the emotions that ran through my heart that day, the one that held anchor was pride. Pride that I had honestly portrayed what life at FSU had been like, and FSU had been a dream to me. I'd wanted to attend since I was a junior in high school and was blown away by how beautiful the campus was. University of Florida was flat, spread out, and too clean, like a ninth grade girl with daddy issues. I forget I wrote some of this shit sometimes. The University of Central Florida was too new and barely had alumni. University of Miami was in god-awful Miami, but FSU was lush, rich, colorful, full of hills. At UF, UCF, or USF, you needed a car to get from class to class, an idea that I wasn't into. At FSU, where the female undergrads outnumbered the men 3-1, all you needed to get by was basic conversation skills. And boy, I fucking had those. I didn't really use them, but I had them. That's not in the book. I just put that in. My first day on campus, I fell in love 9 times, made 5 new friends, got drunk, got high, and managed to make it to orientation. That first semester, I passed all my classes with only minimal attendance and effort. And that became my credo. Take the classes that people told you were easy, show up when need be, and party. I won't say all the kids who attended FSU were only there to party, but all the kids I knew were there for the exact same reason, to have a good time and get a college degree. I learned to drink, a lot. I also learned that when drinking, I could make people laugh and often found myself at the head of a table. I enjoyed being the center of attention, the life of the party. By the time Rolling Stone found me, I had developed a reputation as the guy you had to party with. After the article came out, things got weird. It's hard to picture now with reality TV making the outrageous seem so mundane, but in 1997, with no precedent like Snooki or Honey Boo Boo, a college kid talking candidly about living a carefree life of excess got the media's attention. TV shows came to Tallahassee to meet me. Radio stations called every 15 minutes from as far away as Australia. ESPN sent a pre-jackass Johnny Knoxville to party with me on a tour bus. And for one semester, I was truly famous in the town I cherished. As I sat next to the recently drafted running back Warwick Dunn during graduation, talking about our big future plans for our now famous selves, I thought to myself, I must be the luckiest man in the world. What I didn't know then was that one of my writing teachers had overheard someone making the false claim that I had a book deal with Random House, and that he, therefore, had decided to fail me out of spite. Having spent 6.5 years working the system, I knew it was almost unheard of to fail a graduating senior. So the next week, I went to the instructor's office and made the plea the administration office had informed me was necessary. He stopped me mid-sentence. I don't give a shit. You can go fuck yourself. I'm not going to help you. You've skipped your way through life without a care in the world and succeeded. Now you have a movie deal and a book deal and a stand-up comedy career. You're fucking famous. Why do you need me? Why do you need a college degree? Go out to Hollywood and make yourself millions. But I'm only 3 credits short, and your creative writing class is the one, and it's a subjective or objective. I don't really remember. I always get those mixed up. He didn't laugh. He leaned forward in his chair and seethed. I've been writing my entire adult life. I take it very seriously, and here you come, blacking out, smoking pot, shitting, skipping classes, and you get a book deal? And to make things even worse, you and your partying lifestyle has sullied the very university I'm trying to get my degree from. I will never pass you. I am not going to help you, and there's nothing you can do to change my mind. Please leave my office. Dumbstruck, I walked out of his office and left Florida State for good. As it turned out, it was the best thing that ever happened to me. I moved to New York and started a career in stand-up comedy that has taken me around the world and onto stages in places I could have never imagined. First, however, at the insistence of my father, I had to enroll via correspondence in what turned out to be the 2 hardest classes I've ever taken in my fucking life. These were pre-internet classes, just a box of books and a test sent to me through the state of Florida, the same classes given to the inmates at the correctional facilities. In the end, I managed to get the credits I needed to get my degree, and today I sit here, that's how long this book took, people! A 40-year-old college graduate, barely, sincerely wondering, what if I had studied harder? What if I had partied less, taken life more seriously, not fucked around at every opportunity, and focused more on the academics like every teacher I ever had told me I should? I'm not sure what the answer is, but I can say with 100% certainty that had I been more serious, had I been more focused, I would not be doing what I am doing now, and that is making people laugh for a living. I wouldn't be selling out comedy clubs, I wouldn't be appearing regularly on radio or television, and I definitely wouldn't be hosting my own TV show. I would have never robbed a train with the Russian mafia, swam with great white sharks, fought a bear, played arena football, been mauled by a bull, jumped out of a plane with Rachel Ray, partied with David Lee Roth, or thrown Johnny Knoxville down a flight of stairs. I would have absolutely nothing to write about, and maybe I'd be just as bitter as the teacher who told me to go fuck myself 15 years ago. I'm gonna ad-lib this, but dude, I don't remember your fucking name. I remember that hot closet of an office you had. I remember the look on your face, and I know you remember the look on my face when you told me to go fuck myself. I thought I was getting pranked, and I've never run into an asshole like you in my entire life. Now I'll read what I wrote. I don't remember that teacher's name, but I hope he's still sitting in his tiny closet of an office reading this paragraph. He definitely remembers me, and if by any chance you're reading this, teacher, I hope this book makes you angry beyond belief and frustrated that you never got out of Tallahassee and lived a life worth writing about, and even more angry knowing full well that I just misspelled Tallahassee. Chapter 1, Worthy Keeper of the Annals. I never suffered from stage fright. As a matter of fact, I suffer from the exact opposite of stage fright. I suffer from the fear of not getting on stage, of not grabbing the spotlight, of letting a potentially magical moment slip by. I'm not sure what drives it, nor am I sure how to control it. All I know is that I will give it a 3-count of noble no's before I risk making a complete ass out of myself. Bert, you should get up there and say something. No. 1. Seriously, the mic's open. I think it's a bad idea. 2. It would be hilarious. Really? 3. Yeah! And I'm off. There have been some beauties and some beasts, more often than not beasts. And it's those ugly ones that are generally remembered the longest, but there have been a handful of beauties too. My earliest recollection is entering first grade. I had a very hard time with separation anxiety my first week. I'd previously gone to a school where my mom taught and my sister attended, so I don't think I had a firm grasp on what entering first grade entailed, the inherent gravity of it. It dawned on me when I got in my dad's van that morning and we left for school, alone. As we merged onto the interstate and into traffic, I felt my stomach swirl. I was in the system. My dad, like everyone else on the road, was thinking about the traffic. But for me, the fact that I was alone with my dad felt odd. We hadn't spent a lot of time alone up until then. I was still too young, and he was working a lot. He must have noticed my unease, because halfway to school, he asked me what was going on.
Nothing.
Are you sure?
Do you think it would be okay for you not to go to work today and maybe hang out with me at my new school?
I'll hang out for a while, but I'm gonna have to go to work at some point.
Well, maybe you could just like skip work and hang out, like outside the classroom.
I think they have rules against that, buddy. We went back and forth like this all the way to my new school, up the stairs and into my classroom, where I began to melt down. This is the parenting job my dad pulled on me. Here's the deal. I won't go anywhere. I'll sit in the parking lot all day in my van until you're done with school. If you need me, you just come out to the parking lot and you get me. And I fucking believed him for the first 10 minutes of first grade. It was then that I politely informed my teacher, Miss Thompson, that I would be taking a little break from the introductory portion of today's lesson and heading out to the parking lot. I explained that I had just about had my fill with being without my family, and I needed to find my dad, who had promised to be waiting in his van in case such a situation were to arise. She explained in her soft southern accent that my dad had gone to work, he was not in the parking lot, and I was going nowhere. To say I took this news poorly is like saying DMX has some bumps on his driving record. Tears turned into sobs, which turned into panic, which turned into sheer panic, which turned into mayhem. I made my way from desk to desk, kid to kid, explaining that we may never see our parents again. Miss Thompson had lost control. Her only hope was to get me back on her side to help calm the kids down, so we made a pact. I would do first grade peacefully as long as I got to sit at the front of the class, my desk next to her, holding her hand. What can I tell you? I'm a straight-up gangster. That year, I discovered the band Kiss, and with that discovery, found my life's direction. Whenever I could, I would dress up in as much drag as I could pull together from my mom's closet, threw on as much makeup as I could sneak, and performed solo renditions, earphones on, in our living room. Shouted Out Loud was my preferred jam, although Rock and Roll All Night and Party Every Day inspired some stellar solo performances. A couple of my uncles were living with us at the time, trying to start a band, and they would go wild with laughter at my one-man show, which I couldn't hear due to the headphones. They would suggest dance moves, wardrobe choices, and mock guitar licks for my benefit and their amusement. I jumped at the coaching, following them to a T. Come Christmas, I was a goddamn air-guitaring Jimi Hendrix. So you can imagine the excitement that overwhelmed me when I first caught wind of our elementary school talent show. Finally, all my training could be put to use. I almost felt bad for the kids who had to muster together some kind of performance in just a matter of weeks, while I had been rehearsing since August. I kept a lid on my project, though, and practiced even more dutifully than before. I listened more closely to my uncle's guidance as they sipped their Heinekens, and I kept my eye on the prize. Come talent show morning, I was ready. I told my mom the night before that I had entered and I needed to borrow some of her clothes. My mom, hands down the most supportive woman I have ever known in my entire life, didn't offer the least bit of resistance. She dressed me to the nines. I would handle my own hair and makeup. My mom walked me through what to put on and how to apply it. I had to pretend secretly that I hadn't been putting on her makeup for months. That's true. I met my dad at the front door for school that morning, shirtless, in my mom's pantyhose, with chains draped across my chest, cowboy boots, a cape, and a tote bag full of product. My dad blinked. What the fuck is this? I have a talent show today, and this is my costume. Does your mother know about this? She dressed me. Oh, fucking of course she did. That is still their relationship to this day. After he conferred with my mom for a minute, we drove silently for 25 minutes to downtown Tampa. In hindsight, I imagine my dad acted with me the same way he would if he had to, say, give a transvestite a ride home. But at the time, I thought nothing of it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.